Like this question to me, I don't know, sometimes I actually get frustrated trying to answer it because I'm actually kind of, if I'll be totally honest, I'm actually kind of tired of the question. I'd rather just do history. I'd rather just do history, and then if I'm doing history with my iPhone or with a browser, with HTML, or with a pen and paper, it's still like history and technology. Like there's always some kind of technology involved. So to me, like digital history shouldn't be any different than just doing any other kind of history. It's all about learning about the past, how you'd use it, how you'd apply it to any, like, you know, current situations, learning about ourselves as human beings. It's just that. And to me, like, digital history, the really great thing about that is its ability to be, or it's more democratic. It has the potential to be more democratic. It certainly has the potential to be less democratic because there's like certain levels of knowledge with how to use the technology and things like that. But you know, I think that its potential to open up, you know, historical practice and conversation is to me like its biggest advantage, like its main selling point, the thing that I'm really interested in. I mean, it's really interesting for me to like to do digital history is to put up a personal archive of family photos and to like get some history out that wouldn't otherwise be shareable. In a way that other people, other cultures, other situations can learn from that. We have tools that certainly can. The way that we look at sources certainly has changed radically. It's more about how many sources we can get in the quickest amount of time. It's more about like mining that for patterns or for common occurrences, or maybe like something uncommon that you couldn't otherwise do if you're just looking at something like one at a time. I certainly think that's a useful. I mean that's Bill Turkell's like whole thing about like the methodology for the infinite archive. I think too that changes how we think of a source. Like certainly like the work that I'm doing on like you know, history of web design and things like that. Like I'm looking at sources, I'm looking at HTML files and CSS files and trying to read those things kind of, you know, as a historian, but certainly like as a programmer or developer too. So I have kind of both of those worlds there. I first got interested in digital history was at Virginia Tech. We took a class, Kathleen Jones taught it. I can't actually remember the name of it. I think it was just digital history. All the scholarship I was actually reading was, this is actually the reason why I applied to CH&M and applied to George Mason, because all the scholarship at the time was written by Roy Rosenzweig or Paula Patrick or Michael Malley. You know, most of it was, it's actually like, it's kind of interesting. I mean, it's either like the Valley of the Shadow, like certainly like that's like the, that's the hallmark or the gold standard for most digital scholarship. But a lot of it too is just individual, you know, scholars or academics or just people who just had some web space and just said, here, I have some sources or I have like an idea about these and just put it up on the web. Like they weren't worried about, they weren't worried too much about like the design or anything like that. They were worried more about, here's the information. I have something I actually want to share. What do you think about it? It's much more, getting back to that democratic thing, it's much more like, I have a voice, I'm going to say something about it. If you think it's interesting, awesome. If you don't, then, you know, I guess I haven't hurt anybody. Like, there's no, like, grandstanding or no, like, you earn your reputation by what you publish it. It's more about what you're saying. And that's the thing that really appealed to me about doing digital scholarship, was that ability to just, it was actually built a lot of confidence to, that was, I guess, my first. That's really an encounter. I guess that's my first impression of like digital scholarship, which I think is the better question than I had in like Roy's class when I took it, Clio 1, where, I mean, there's this interesting tension, I guess, between like your ability to do digital scholarship, like how much technology should you know? Because Valley of the Project, like the article that Ayers and Will Thomas did is fantastic, but it's also like a big project that had a lot of grad students, I think, and, you know, like a lot of people working on this one article versus, you know, some guy with a blog and like some pictures that he scanned. And, you know, the Ayers and Thomas article is fantastic as far as like the quality, the design, the writing. But like, I don't think this is a question that we have really addressed adequately in digital history or digital humanities is like, the barriers between doing, well, one, like, how do we define, like, quality digital scholarship? And two, like, either lowering the barriers for publishing that kind of stuff, or either lowering our, I don't say lowering our expectations, because that sounds terrible, but, yeah, I don't know. I'm trying to think of the word to describe that, but yeah, that's something we haven't really talked about. And I think projects like Omeka, like that's the whole thing that we're trying to do with Omeka. We're trying to like lower the barrier to building an archive or an exhibit, just a little bit, you know. So and I think that's one direction we've kind of gone in with our digital projects. So I kind of have probably two answers to that. I don't know if I should give the one answer, if this is going to be public. No, I'll go ahead and keep it anyway. I mean, I think there's definitely concern about whether, I have two answers. One is like from the actual like PhD program at Mason. The other is like from my experience working, you know, at teaching the class at American University. Most of the students at American University, I'll start with them because I'm teaching that class. Most of them are like really, really interested in learning about the technology, about how they can use it in their work. A lot of them, I'd say most of them are either some undergrads, most of them are master's students. You know, very few actually, there are a few doing PhDs or are going to do PhDs. Most of them are master's students, either doing public history or applied history or some kind. So they're actually, you know, they're very, very eager, very interested in learning how they can use the technology, the tools for digital history to actually improve their practice of history. They still have like the history of mind, right? They've almost never lost that. But they see how they can use, you know, digital tools to improve that or to change the way that they do history. They're much more positive about it. They're still, like, critical. And I think you have to be that way. You still have to be critical, but you can still be critical but be, you know, positive about it or certainly, like, not negative about it. And then there's some people who don't see, and I've encountered this a lot, like, in the PhD program at Mason, that a lot of people don't see the benefits, I guess, immediately. And, you know, and to be fair, like, a lot of that is, it takes time to actually learn. It takes a long time to learn HTML, and HTML was designed to be simple to learn, really, but it still takes a lot of time to learn the nuances of it, and to do it really well. Yeah, so there's, you know, I think there are those two reactions. Either, like, you're very positive but critical, and then there's some that it's hard to see the immediate benefits because it is frustrating. It's frustrating to learn PHP. It's frustrating to check, like, seven different browsers just because you want something to float left or float right or, you know, left and right. I got that wrong right there, but, yeah. And I sympathize with that. If you mean traditional history as, like, the academic monograph published by a university press, no, absolutely not, I don't think. It can, certainly, but I mean, I think it definitely reaches a broader audience. It definitely has the potential to reach a broader audience, but I think a lot of that is, there's a lot more, I think, like, self-promotion with digital history projects that, you know, on the web, there are, like, billions of web pages, right? And, you know, to get your project out there, you have to do more than just buy a domain and put it up on a server. You actually have to, like, you know, tell people about it in a lot of different ways. And you don't necessarily, traditional academics don't actually do this with their books, I don't think. Like, I don't, you know, they go to, like, the conferences, and I guess sometimes they stand by, like, the book, you know, stand where their books are getting sold. They may sign some copies or something like that. But it's not really, there's not the same level of outreach, I guess, as there. This is one thing at CHNM we've done a lot of, that we've learned a lot, is to do, like, outreach for projects. Because you have to do that if you want people to find it and use the stuff. And I don't think that's a bad thing. I think that's actually a good thing to do. I think you kind of have to get on Twitter and say, hey, I, you know, wrote this blog post, or as much as I hate Facebook, get on Facebook and say, you know, we have a new project, and put your links up on Wikipedia, and go to places where other people aren't, that already are, the public is. Because if you don't do that, if we don't go there, if we don't go to the places where the public already is, they're not going to find it. Yeah, I mean, I think that, I mean, it kind of goes back to, like, the thing I was talking about with, like, the difference between, like, the students at, like, AU that I teach and the ones at Mason. There are a lot of times, and I've talked about this at CHNM, Center for History and New Media, a lot, that sometimes we're in a bubble that, like, like, we're critical of the work that we're doing, but we're also very enthusiastic, and we're confident that we can come up with something that's really useful. But, you know, we don't get the same negative feedback, you know, when we're just working at CHNM, and when we're on, you know, Twitter with, like, the other 500-600 people who are also really enthusiastic about what we're doing. I mean, my experience, like, with both, like, outside the history department at Mason, I mean, the department at Mason is, like, very supportive of the program. You know, and sees its benefits. Like, even if you're just taking the Clio 1 and Clio 2 class, that even just learning that stuff and just being familiar with it so that you can talk to a programmer or a web designer. You don't actually have to do it yourself, but just to be able to have the conversation in a more, you know, I guess, knowledgeable manner is very helpful. I think that acquiring that, what's the word, that you know, that knowledge or that ability to communicate like that is much more positive, that people see the benefits of that. Like, actually, like, learning the skills and, like, taking, like, a semester or two semesters to build a website, that I think that's slowly improving. But like I said, like, that where it takes so much time that I think that, you know, that a year is a long time in a PhD program, and we want to, like, spit PhDs out, like, every 5 or 6 years. I think for that to really improve, especially in history, and I don't know if this is the case, like, in a lot of places, that we kind of have to change the way that we teach classes and change the structure. And we actually talked about this a little bit at CHNM about how we need to have more, like, kind of studio classes or what's another word for it? Well, like labs, where we just, you know, we get people and we say, we have a semester to build this project. Here's all the skills we're going to learn, and, you know, there's a practical benefit at the end. Instead of just, you know, reading, you know, 2 or 3 books a week or articles a week and then saying that you know something about digital history when you actually haven't built anything or done any technology out of it. I think if we did that would help improve, like, the training of the people who would get the jobs, who would then, like, improve the opinion of visual history. But one thing that I've noticed, and, like, I don't want to get into, like, a personal, like, psychotherapy session with you guys, but, like, I mean, the more I do this stuff and learn this stuff, the more that I realize it really impacts my personal relationships with, like, my family and people I don't know or don't understand, but I want to understand. And I feel like, I don't know, I kind of feel like humanities can, like, help resolve, like, a lot of, you know, problems and misunderstandings that we tend to have with each other. And I certainly think that, like, the digital aspect of this makes it much more possible. I have a lot of, like, disagreements with my parents about, like, political issues and cultural issues and things like that. And like, I think learning these things and being able to share this kind of stuff with, you know, my family and friends and things like that has really improved my relationships with them. So it's very selfish. It's like, I like humanities in the digital age because, like, I want to have better interpersonal relationships and learn, like, from, you know, other people I don't know, or people that I thought I knew but can't really relate to until I learn a little bit more about them. So that may be sappy, but I've been thinking about this on this road trip because I've been stuck with, like, my family in a car for, like, 2 days, and so that's kind of where I'm at.